the Stations of the Cross is about a journey, 1 to 14, following the Christ's condemnation right through to the body of Christ being laid in the grave. It's a tradition, but really the point of it isn't so much specifically the various separate incidents. It's actually the notion of a body of work following Christ's journey, which is intended to encourage reflection and meditation. So people are encouraged to think about the suffering of Christ, and of course the notion is to think about the journey through life. And that's essentially, I guess that's why it's still a fundamental part of Catholicism. It's really a meditative body of work. So that crosses over into art fairly quickly because, you know, apart from the Stations of the Cross, as they've traditionally been portrayed with Christ the soldiers, you then also have people like Rothko or Colin McCann, and McCann especially, a body or a series of works which you can walk past. The notion is that you begin at one point with the work and you follow them around the room, and it takes you on a journey, but it's not just a physical journey. It's actually also the notion of, I guess, reflecting, thinking and considering, and at the end of that there may in fact be some, you know, some gaining of knowledge or revelation, or possibly just frustration. But I mean, that's really the most fundamental aspect, I guess, of the Stations of the Cross. It's intended to invite reflection about the human condition. In a way, one of the artists is very close in spirit to these works is Grunewald's the Eisenheim altarpiece, and because that work focuses absolutely on the suffering of Christ on the cross, and again it's a metaphor for the suffering of humanity. So it's an expressionist tradition, and it's something obviously I think John Badcock, as an expressionist painter, is very close to the spirit and the intention of those works. About McCann and the Stations of the Cross. I mean, there's two main works. One's The Shining Cuckoo, and the other one is Walk, which is the notion of a walk along Murawai Beach. It was shortly after James K. Baxter had died, so he was thinking about, McCann was thinking about this notion of walking along the beach with Baxter, and of course the notion of them both as artists, prophets, and he'd numbered the images of the beach. There are no figures in it, but he'd numbered the images of the beach 1 to 14. And so the notion was that it was like the Stations of the Cross. But it's interesting because the landscape that McCann depicts is very formal and very ordered, and it's meditative and reflective in a way in which it's like McCann stepped back from his subject and he's looking at it and thinking and reflecting. Whereas with these, I think that it feels to me like John Badcock's actually really right in the middle of the issue and the landscape and the dilemma. McCann's actually far more optimistic than these works are. McCann is, he delivers his audience, I think, he delivers them actually almost on a spiritual salvation in that work. Feels to me, he said speculatively, as though John's probably still, he's right in the middle of that journey. And he's just asking that we will reflect and think about that as well, as people do. This is not the Stations of the Cross like most Stations of the Cross, because it's very much a man alone. There's this one individual, Christ, or possibly the artist, or possibly the viewer, and the notion of a journey through life. And it's one in which, really, if you look at the landscape and the figure, the way the paint's been put on, just physically, there's very little difference between foreground, background, and middle distance. It's one and the same. So you have this sense of a figure in a kind of a vortex in a landscape that's really very ungiving, uncaring, indifferent to, and he's struggling. Even if this figure isn't Christ, whoever it is, this figure is struggling as they move around towards the final scene. And you notice too, the first one, it begins with a gravesite, really, doesn't it? Christ is condemned to death, and that's where it finishes. So on one level, you could say that it's a kind of an existential take on human existence, on existence, isn't it? And there's a really nice quote from Michael Smither when he was in Otago in the early 70s about, he said he felt like a man alone wandering around in the Sinai Desert. And that's not an inappropriate, you know, analogy to make with this show as well, in terms of the South Island landscape and that figure of the artist. You know, the other comparisons, obviously, with someone like Turner, where nature is, you know, the whole notion of the nature in a vortex, it does share those qualities as well. One of the things that really surprised and impressed me is the painting process. It's a, even if you don't know what the subject is, just to look at the paint and the way he's applied it on the surfaces, it's pretty amazing, very impressive. It's an engaging body of work, just in terms of the sheer materials and processes. It's really interesting that he's taken the imagery to that point where it could be pure paint, you know, just a purely painterly surface with no, not necessarily with the subject, but the figure is sort of just held there. The tradition of localising Christian stories in the present day and in the New Zealand landscape, again, it's a central idea to a lot of landscape painting as contemporary landscape developed in the 40s and 50s in New Zealand. The second one, you know, Christ, the cross is laid upon Christ. That's a really interesting one, I think, because as soon as I saw that, it's sort of like the burden of whatever the artist is going to do, or the burden of being, you can read it as the burden of being an artist, or the burden that everyone faces born into life. And there's this large black shape hanging over the top, descending almost, and then the landscape again behind. And I think it's interesting too, if you look at the three of Christ, where Christ falls, this one here, Christ falls for the third time, and you've got the landscape looming behind him, and that, you know, it's like he's almost dissolving, disappearing into the land, and the landscape is just this momentous, absolutely overwhelming force. It's a really interesting palette actually, because it is very ochre and it's very earthen, and again it fits perfectly with the intentions and the ideas behind the works. There's so many different ways you can read this, but I was thinking before that in some ways there's something quite ancient Celtic about this, the notion of the body going back into the land and regenerating and giving life again. The fact that he's reduced the imagery down to the landscape and essentially almost one figure, and the darkness and the light, those two contrasts, it certainly is inviting symbolic rather than just pure. I mean, you know, to read it literally wouldn't really do it justice. Well, I think it's intended that you should take what you want from it. I think John Badcock made the point about his father talking about God's creation of the landscape, and then he talks about these as being his own personal journey through life. But I don't think you need to know that coming into the show. I think that essentially, considering, I guess, the fundamental aspect of the Stations of the Cross being the passion of Christ in his last hours, carrying the cross and then being crucified and buried, the notion of that, it's really a beginning point, isn't it, for people to reflect on the journey and the burden of life, really, really serious, heavy questions and important questions that people struggle with from the moment they're born.